What's going on, Fallbrook family? As we continue on with this amazing series, Habits, and now we're moving towards the end of it, we want to continue on asking these questions to you all, and even this time we went to our Fallbrook staff to ask them what are some good habits you may have, but also some bad habits. Let's check it out.
A good habit that I have is that I like to make to-do lists and have everything planned out for my day. A bad habit that I have is that I like to stick to the plan and that whenever I have to deviate from it, it bothers me, and I'm learning that sometimes it is what it is and I can just do it tomorrow. One of my good habits that I have is that I like to be organized, very structured, and plan out everything. I like to stick to the plans. And one of my not so good habits is if I had the chance to sleep all day, I would do just that.
One of my bad habits is that I am a huge procrastinator. I have a tendency to do stuff at the last minute, and I need to work better at that. One of my good habits is that I'm pretty good with managing money. I feel like if you save your money and if you spend your money wisely, you'll become more successful in life.
Let's show the Lord some love. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Dear God, we are so delighted, Father, to be here again, to be able to worship and celebrate just how awesome and amazing you are. And so, Father, we thank you for this time of the year where we as the church, we celebrate the price that was paid for our salvation. And we thank you for the gift, the marvelous gift of Jesus, where he showed us just how much he loves each and every one of us. And so, Father, we now ask that you might use this person that stands before these people that you love so much, your people. And we pray that you might use him in a way that you see fit to bring you a tremendous amount of glory. So we offer this prayer in the wonderful name of Jesus. May the church say together, amen. Let's show the Lord some love. Amen. 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 Turn in your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 4 as we continue looking at this subject on habits. And so we are going to progress from the good habits of husbands and wives. We're moving on from that, and we'll discuss today the types of habitual behavior from parents that God uses to bless his children. You might think those kids belong to you, but they are the Lord's. So let's get right on it. Turn to Ephesians 6 and verse 4. Fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in athletics. Bring them up with a good education. Bring them up so they can have a good job. But bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. You may be seated. Certainly, habits are a way of life. This series of messages hinges on the fact that being spirit-filled is the basis or foundation for having good habits in all of our human relationships, husband-wife, parent-child, so forth, so on. So being spirit-filled is the basis for having good habits in all human relationships. So when it comes to godly good habits in these human relationships, we mentioned last time that there's no shortcuts. And it's all about the spirit-filled life. So in every single one of our human relationships, if we want that relationship to grow and excel, it's all about the spirit-filled life, and that is allowing the Spirit of God to control us. People talk about being spirit-filled, but the Spirit don't control them. And so it doesn't matter. You can speak in tongues all day long. You can make a loud noise. You can run across an auditorium and say that you're spirit-filled. But if the Spirit is not controlling your life, it is impossible for you to know what this spirit-filled life is all about. And so the key, you know, to this series, as we look at habits, is going to be the spirit-filled life, and especially when it comes to relationships. And so we are currently at a dangerous crossroads with our children today. You know, we're at a crossroads. There are some serious things on the table, and as we are at this crossroads, there are two very, very polarizing extremes that are certainly not fixing the challenges we have set before us. The first extreme, as we are at this crossroad with our children, is the too rigid extreme. And the too rigid extreme believes a punitive approach will fix the issue going on with our children today. You see, those with the too rigid extreme and this punitive approach, they believe sicking the criminal justice system on our children is the answer. They believe that the answer is the criminal justice system, and when our children do wrong, that they ought to be turned over to the criminal justice system in order to fix them, their problems, and their lives. And so that is the too rigid extreme. But I noticed something about those that believe in the too rigid extreme. Notice too rigid extreme is that when their kids, say it one more time, when their kids get in trouble, they want it to be handled outside the criminal justice system, but they want our kids to be handled with the criminal justice system. Just in case you didn't know that, kids are pretty similar, and kids have been a certain way forever. That's why the book of Proverbs is written to those that are young to help them to navigate this life, particularly young boys, but certainly young girls can benefit from the Proverbs as well. And so here's the deal. There's been issues with young people forever. You know, this isn't a new thing. And so this idea that somehow certain groups that the only answer for them is the criminal justice system doesn't make sense, because the deal is that there's crime and there's bad doing and bad living with children all over the country. Now, in certain parts of the country, there is over-policing, and I don't want to get into the argument as to why more crime, et cetera, et cetera. That's the reason why there's more police, blah, blah, blah. And so that's not where I want to go at all. I just want us to realize that in some areas, the policing is more domineering and less forgiving than in other areas. Just the way it is. And so you have one of the polarizing extremes is this too rigid extreme. Just lock them all up. Then you have the too loose extreme. And this believes a non-punitive approach will fix the issues with our children. They tend to not believe in any type of corporal punishment when it comes to children. Spanking is certainly out, and things like that. They believe more in getting down to the child's level and trying to understand the child and where the child is. And so this is that more loose extreme. And they believe in this idea of children making their own decisions, and they will eventually begin to figure it out. And so these are those that they believe that children at 9 years old can determine their sexuality and determine whether or not they're supposed to have been male or female. They tend to say that children left to themselves can figure all of that out. They can figure out this difficult thing of sexuality on their own at 9 and 10 years old. They can figure all of that out. And so they have this more loose extreme of just let the kids do whatever they really want to do. And we'll just say a little bit to them, but we really don't want to mess them up because that's helping to develop them. So the too rigid extreme and then the too loose extreme. Now, those that buy into the loose extreme, I hope you realize that on that one, you know, kids that are raised with the loose extreme, they normally set it off more than the other kids. And you don't know when they're going to set it off. That's the problem. You know, you can be with your friends and they just set it off. They tend to set it off more. Now, all kids can set it off, but those that with a loose extreme, they'll set it off anywhere. You'll be at a meeting with a bunch of adults, and they'll roll up in front of all of your friends, your neighbors. They'll embarrass you, and you don't know what they're going to say. And then you're like, oh. Don't be surprised. That's because you're too loose with them. You know what I'm saying? They think they like you and your friends. That's why they roll up on y'all while you're talking and just say whatever they want to say. Too loose extreme, too rigid extreme. I suggest we don't follow either one. So let's look at some good habits for parents. Ephesians 6 and 4 is our focal text. Fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. There are two important layers that underscores why parents' habitual behavior is important in establishing parental authority. What a parent does habitually, that's your regular pattern, will determine what your children believe about your parental authority. And so if you think that you're neutral, you're not neutral. If you think you're being neutral, they finna take over your house. Hand them the keys because they're going to take it over. I've seen children take over a house. Parents are just living there, but it's the kid's house. As my brother and I, we got older, my mom always let us know, if y'all ever get out of control the way y'all think about taking over the house, that's fine. Because I'm just going to pick up and go. Find me another place, but I won't be here. If y'all get big and think y'all going to take over the house. So let's look at this. Let's look at these two layers. The first layer that underscores why parents' habitual behavior is important in establishing parental authority is this. Parents are God's conduit. A parent is God's first and primary way of instilling in a child what authority is all about. It's the parent. The parents are God's conduit to shape a child's paradigm, to shape a child's framework in their mind on authority. You get to impact that a whole lot. That's why my attitude towards adults was shaped primarily by my parents. You know, they were the ones from a small child to where I had to listen at home and I had to listen everywhere else. You know, you feel me? And so they were the primary conduits for God to do that. And this is vital for their lifelong success. Your child's framework on authority will have a lot to do about what kind of success they have in life. If a child doesn't understand authority, their ability to matriculate in a corporate setting is minimum because they don't quite understand authority, so authority don't understand them either. And they certainly not going to elevate somebody who don't understand authority. Parents are the most effective tool to shape their kids' respect for authority, and the schools can't do it. It's too late at kindergarten. You can put on them new shoes for the first day of school, their first time going to school. You can put that backpack on. You can put them nice $150 jeans on that they're going to grow out of in 3 months. You can put the $30 shirt on, $25 haircut. You can have all of that going on, and they smiling with all their supplies and all of that. Teacher has no idea what just walked in the classroom. Handsome, pretty young girl. I mean, just looks like no problems out of this one. If they haven't been taught authority, if they don't understand parental authority, if they don't respond to you, I promise you, they're not going to respond to anybody else. The way how you help educators is that you teach your children to first respect and honor and love and cherish you. So this first layer is parents are God's conduit. Don't you ever forget that. Don't try to blame the school. If your kid don't respect authority, don't you ever blame the school. Ever. You sit with that child and you instill in them that authority must be respected. Now, if they like, you know, 17 and they just want to get off, that's different. But when we're talking about 5 and 6 and 7 year olds, they should understand at that age already who's the boss in the classroom. I remember as a kid, my elementary school at PS 49, principal was a name, Mr. Grant. And I've shared this story before, but I just want to see how real it is. It was back when bald heads wasn't in style. Men did the George Jefferson when they was losing their hair. Isaac Hayes and Mr. Grant were the only two people I knew with a bald head. Period. And he was the scariest thing I've ever seen in my life. But in part because he had a title, the principal. If you were a kid when I was growing up and you were being sent to the principal's office, it went through the whole school. It was like little Leroy was going to prison. You know Leroy going to the principal's office? Going to principal's office? It was just that major. Kids go to principal's office today? You're the first conduit. So the first layer that underscores why parents' habitual behavior is important in establishing parental authority is the parents of God's conduits. And the second one is self-regulation is impossible for children. They can't regulate themselves. And those kids who are regulating themselves, they don't have a proper framework on authority. And they tend to be more, what? Destructive. That's the reason why kids that don't respect authority can get so violent. Because in the absence of authority, in the absence of being regulated, certain things emanate from us. And one of that is this absence of order and structure. And you become more rambunctious and want to move and use your mouth and curse and swing. It can be very, very, very destructive, those that don't understand authority. You know, and I want you to realize this. It's hard for adults to self-regulate, isn't it? If your job told you tomorrow, y'all do whatever y'all want to do, right? And you know that in order for the company to be successful, certain things you have to do. But y'all do whatever you want to do. I guarantee you that you're going to take that literally and you're going to say, I can come in whenever I want to come in, right? I mean, hold on. I can say whatever I want to say. I can leave whatever I want to say. If it's a customer service call and I don't like the person and they're getting loud with me, you just say blah, 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 and you hang up on them and say I'm done. It's hard to self-regulate. There's not a whole lot of people to where if they go on a job and you could tell them to just, you got a flexible schedule. That's why on most jobs, most people don't. Because it's difficult for people to self-regulate themselves. In fact, most people can't. Most people need a whole lot of regulation. And so if it's difficult, it's hard for adults to self-regulate, then we know it's going to be impossible for children to self-regulate. I don't self-regulate at Fallbrook. I can't go to the bank and get money. My name is not on the account. I don't self-regulate to determine all these things. I am regulated by this system of Fallbrook Church. I'm not self-regulated to determine, you know, well, you know, this, that, and the other. I don't have, you know, girlfriends, and I certainly don't have boyfriends. Understand what, you know, we got to be regulated. We got to have established an order and structure that tells you, you can do this or you can't do this. If you do this, this is the consequences. There's a consequence placed on me that I gave and shared with the elders years ago. If I can't do right here, y'all need to fire me. If I go find a girlfriend, y'all need to fire me. I'm the founding pastor. I didn't have to set it up like that. I say, if I get out of order, if I steal the money, if I do any of that kind of thing, it is done for me here at Fallbrook. Because I understand that self-regulation is what get pastors in trouble. You need to be regulated. Children need to be regulated. So here's what it looked like when a parent's habitual behavior around their kids establishes parental authority. You want to see what it looked like? It's all in the text. The first one is sensible parental authority when it talks about not provoking your children to anger. Parental authority must be from habitual behavior that is sensible and not irrational. Because irrational parental authority, the Bible says, provokes children to anger. Are we provoking our kids to anger? Is your behavior irrational? It is irrational to bring some dude into your apartment, your house, that cusses you out, that cusses your kids out, that treats you like a dog, that is irrational. You feel me? That is the kind of stuff that provokes anger from these kids, and that's why they hate that dude. You feel me? They hate him. If they could kill him, they would kill him. Why? Because of the way how they see him treat their mother. It provokes them to anger. So watch this. Being irrational in our conversation. Don't talk to your kid like you would somebody on the street. You know, cuss words that'll make the devil blush. And this is why we continue to do this kind of stuff. It's because we say, well, everybody cuss. It's this thing going around where everybody says, everybody cusses at their kids. Can I just say something to you? And don't get upset with me. But I hope you do know that that's a lie. Everybody doesn't cuss out their children. Whenever we do stuff, we want to say everybody's doing it because it makes us feel better about ourselves. Everybody don't commit adultery and fornication and steal and rob and rob old people and do. Everybody doesn't do that. Everybody don't cheat on their taxes. Everybody don't do that. You know what I'm saying? Everybody don't cheat a little bit here, a little bit there. Everybody don't do that. The first time Christians start saying everybody does something, what it's saying is that God doesn't have any victorious Christians. That there's no victory in Christ. And even if a lot of people do it, it does not matter. Do not provoke your children to anger. Irrational parental behavior can incite the worst in our kids, from them becoming bitter, resentful, and angry people. Wow. So habitual parental behavior, sensible parental behavior. I mean authority, parental authority. Okay, let's look at another one. Habitual parental behavior of what? Nurturing. Good, solid parental authority. Watch this. Bring them up in our text means to do what? It means to nourish. And nourishing what? Their spiritual and emotional needs. And not just their physical needs. We have a problem today. I have this problem. Many of you may have this problem, but you know, I certainly have it. Some of you may, but I do. To where I have more than what my parents had. I'm able to do more for my children than my parents were able to do for me. And what can happen is that as parents today, that our parents couldn't do before because they didn't have as much as we have today. Kids wasn't going back and forth to Disney World or Six Flags or this. They didn't have nine different, you know, this, that, and the other at the house, you know, 20 pair of sneakers, and they have all that. They weren't able to make trips and go to restaurants and hang out with their friends and everybody driving. They ain't have all that. So we have this issue of trying to equate taking care of our children's physical needs with being enough for them. It's not enough to take them to Six Flags. It's not enough to take them to Disney World. It's not enough to buy them a car. It's not enough to get them good stuff for Christmas. It's not enough for them to have nice sneakers. It's not enough for them to always have a nice haircut. It's not enough. It's not enough to have name brand food in the pantry. It's not enough to have soda all in the house. It's not enough to have Capri Sun. It's not enough to have all kind of candy in the house. That's not enough. That's not what the Bible is talking about when it talks about this whole idea of us nourishing, bringing them up, nourishing our children. It is talking about their spiritual and emotional needs. Some parents parent for the physical. As long as they keep giving their kids stuff and their kids seem to be happy, they think they're a successful parent. And look how many of us grew up. My mother didn't have the resources to be buying me a whole bunch of stuff. You see what I'm saying? I had to go get a job. I had to go get my own stuff. My mother understood that other things were important. You know, understand what I'm saying? When I got up in the morning, you know, all through middle school and high school, my mom would get do her hair and stuff in a small little mirror. We had a small little washing machine over there, and every morning, just about it, miss maybe a few, I would just sit down with my mom for a few minutes, and we would just talk. Understand what I'm saying? Is that we got to realize that our kids' spiritual and emotional needs are vital. It's not just what you buy for them. Parents are the key for a balanced growth plan for their kids. And why? So they can grow up like Jesus. How did he grow up? The Bible says he kept increasing in wisdom and stature and favor with God and with men. You want them to grow up like Jesus. Nourish them spiritually and mentally. Next. Let's look at this next item, regulatory parental authority, which is crucial that parents do this as a habit. Discipline in the text is the parent's regulatory authority to do what? To set boundaries. Parents must set boundaries. Set Proverbs 22:6, boundaries for kids, when the Bible says, train up a child in the way he should go in. And when he's old, he will not depart from it. That is about setting up boundaries. This training is setting up boundaries in our kids' lives. Parents are God's primary regulators for kids, and the boundaries that we set are essential. But not only set up boundaries, but the Bible says to apply corrections for your kids. Proverbs 13:24 says, he who withholds his rod hates his son, but he who loves him disciplines him diligently. Parents are God's primary regulators for kids for boundaries and correction. You've got to correct your children. Don't wait for the police to correct them. Every time somebody that looked like us has an encounter with law enforcement, it is potentially a life-threatening situation. And I'm not arguing the rights or wrong of that, because there is some inerrant fear of people that look like us, that were over-criminalized in the minds of people, and we need to make sure our children are corrected by us first. Because some of the forms of correction might lead to death. Ordering your child's life from boundaries and corrections may not make them rich, but it will help them to do well in life. You say, how do you know that? Because Ephesians 6:1-3 says, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with a promise. Why get with authority? Why? So that it may be well with you and that you may live a long life on the earth. There is something powerful about order. Do you know that if we would make sure our children in school, if they leave with order, they don't necessarily have to have and be the smartest and be the sharpest knife in the drawer. You say, why is that so? Because somebody may not be the smartest student, but if they go find a job somewhere, apply a lot of places, find a job, and if they understand order, they could submit to authority, they could start out at a cash register, and they can end a VP in the company. That order, that's that order, boundaries and correction. Correct your children, and don't wait for the teachers to do it. Don't wait for somebody else. Get with them. So next is instructional parental authority. So we had discipline. Now instruction. Instruction in the text. Now watch this. You gotta catch this, or you could possibly miss it. Instruction in the text is information-driven. and not driven by boundaries and correction. Some parents are good at boundaries. Don't do this, don't do that. Here's the rules. Correct, 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 which they need to do, but they forget about the information. Not that you become a child with your kid, but you speak to your child from an adult perspective to them to give them information that along their maturity line in life, as they elevate, they understand and they can make better decisions. So instruction is information driven. So watch this. Instructional authority from parents is for children to get the right information and filter out false information. Don't you want your kids to have the right information? So years ago, parents spent more time on boundaries and correction. That's how many of us grew up, with more boundaries and correction. Parents didn't do a whole lot of talking years ago. Nah, it wasn't a whole lot of talking. No. They just looked at you, and hey, it wasn't a whole lot of talking. But just because that was the way it was done before doesn't mean that, now again, you don't acquiesce, but instruction has to take place. The Bible just say the discipline part, it says the instruction part. So now you got to explain to this little dude, this, and this. They ain't going to get it the first time. Again, you keep repeating, little dude. This, and this. They ain't gonna go, blah, 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 blah. Little dude, now he's a little bit older. This, and this. But with your information, you got what? Boundaries and correction. With information, you cooking with hot grease then. Because now they're balanced with the boundaries, the correction, and the information. Why? So they can get the right information and filter out the false stuff. Parental instruction is more important now than ever before. You say, why? Because children's minds are exposed to adult trash like never before. If your child has a cell phone or a computer that connects to the internet, they have access to the most devastating, deadliest, illicit, explicit information in the world at their fingertips. If you don't know that, then you got a problem. That's why you got to stay in your kids' business. My wife and I, we didn't allow our kids to have their own business. You don't have your own business and you a kid. It is illegal for a 12-year-old to have their own business. Other than like personal business, stuff like that. But in terms of what they have on computers and stuff like that, they're going, well, I just trust me. Your job don't even trust you. We got truck drivers where Amazon is finna start monitoring all of the different things on the trucks. You know what I mean? And some companies have been doing that in the past. And so they telling the truck driver, listen, I know you've been driving a truck for 30 years, but to make sure you ain't going 100 in the 30-mile-an-hour zone, I'm going to monitor everything you do on that truck. How many of you dudes that are truck drivers out there plan on quitting? Hey, ain't nobody talking about quitting. You just gonna start driving the speed limit. It is what it is. 12-year-olds with their own business. Wow. And if you have made that error, you need to change it today. Get every password they got. Wow. Even commercials is adult trash. They got some stuff on commercials, sitting up there with, you know, as a family, and you watching a commercial, and they got some stuff on there, man, that soul, it sends message about about sexuality and all that kind of stuff. It just sends the message. They just throw it in your face. They stomp it in your face, whether you like it or not. And here's the deal. They ought to give a parent the right on a commercial to say what I do and I don't want to pop up in terms of how I want to raise my children, right? They should have a rating system now on commercials. And we got to realize that this thing of instruction has got to come for the parents. It ain't going to come anywhere else. And here's the deal. And we got to stop taking kids and putting them in front of this little at 4 and 5 and 3 and 2 years. I love you. You love me. We are happy. Blah, blah, blah. And because, you know, here's the deal. If that's supplementing what you're doing, that's fine. But if you are depending on Barney, you depending on Barney to teach your kid to be nice and Barney? Wow. Parental instruction is God's design that gives kids a fighting chance against trash that will devastate their lives. Give them a fighting chance. Isn't that all you want? For your kids to have a fighting chance, you're not going to be able to be around them all the time. You can't protect them all the time. All you want them to have is a fighting chance at a good job, right? A fighting chance to be able to move into the neighborhood they want to move to. A fighting chance to be able to succeed in life. A fighting chance. God sent me to let us know, give your kids a fighting chance against all of the trash out there. Give them the instruction they need. A fighting chance. Too many kids don't have a fighting chance. So all they do is throw their hands up and say, I surrender. Because they don't have enough information that's been given to help them in this trash-filled world. You watch the news and spring break and they see just all that. They don't see the kids that do spring break, right? Why the news got to show that's not all of our kids? With no clothes on and all. I mean, that's not all of our kids. Can't you show a few kids? They just went to Hawaii, had a good time, and had some fun. They went here, they went to Galveston, had a good time. Why are they just showing one element? So then kids grow up and they think, oh, they associate spring break, freaking out. Spring break, freaking out. You gotta be the one to filter through that stuff. That's not on the school. It's not on me and Pastor O in this church. It's on you. And if you haven't been doing it, don't beat yourself up. Just make changes. Stop beating yourself up. Well, I want a good parent. I want a good parent. Be a good parent today. Stop beating yourself up. The devil wants you to beat yourself up because he wants you to give up. Say, it's too late for my kids. No, it's not too late for your kids. It's not too late. Do not beat yourself up. Walk in victory and watch God do his thing. Let us pray. Father, we just love you, Lord. I lift up our parents to you in the name of Jesus. I'm going to ask every parent to stretch forth your hand. Stretch forth your hand to the Lord right now. Put forth your hand. Every parent. Every parent. And begin to pray in your heart, God, help me to get better. There's no perfect parents. I'm not a perfect parent. I'm praying right now, God, help Michael Pender to get better as a parent. Call on God right now. Stretch forth your hand like you want God to touch your hand and, oh, God, grab my hand, Lord, grab my hand. I need you. I can't do it on my own. Grab my hand, Lord, grab my hand. Grab my hand, Lord, I need you, I need you, I need you. I haven't seen my son in 10 years. Help me, Lord. Father, speak to some parents right now. Release them. Release them. The enemy wants them to beat them up. And beat them up and beat them up about their mistakes. Release them in the name of Jesus. Release them. Shed your love of mercy and forgiveness all over them. Cover them with the blood of Jesus right now. May this be the dawning of a new day. It won't be perfect days ahead, but just a new day. A new day. God, we give you the glory for what you're doing. You can put your hand down. Now, Father, I pray for those that may need to meet Jesus. You might be a parent and you don't know Jesus. He's never forgiven you of your sins. Well, that means that you can't walk a spirit-filled life if you don't know Jesus. That's part of the challenge. It's the basis of the challenge. Pray right now that you would pray this prayer, and I'm going to pray out loud. You pray it in your heart. If you pray this prayer and you mean it, you will be saved. Period. Pray this prayer in your heart and you mean it, you will be saved. Say, Lord Jesus, thank you for dying for my sins, past, present, and in the future. Thank you. Lord, I ask you to forgive all of my sins, my past sins, my present sins, and my sins of the future. Forgive them all, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me, forgiving me. I want you to control my life, so I want you to be Lord. Declare you to be Lord. Control my life. If you prayed that prayer, you're a believer. You're saved. You've been rescued. Pray others will be praying right now for God to transform them to better parents, better children, better husbands, wives, to get better. Singles. Father, I pray that some that would like to unite with our church, that they would do that as well. So, Holy Spirit, thank you for these moments you give us. May we leave better. May we not leave with a beaten up spirit about our past mistakes, but may we leave declaring victory in Jesus' name. We love you, Lord. In Christ's name, amen. Let's show the Lord some love. Amen.